Good afternoon and most welcome to all of you who are present here at our auditorium at CEP. It is a real privilege to have you all here and share with our people, with the people who are watching us through EMOL TV and our platforms on this important seminar to talk about this new book, Milton Friedman, The Last Conservative, written by Jennifer Burns, who is here. She is a historian at the University of Stanford. And besides having the author, Jennifer, we have the privilege of having with us Rolf Luders, professor of economics at Catholica University. And the only, let me add, the only PhD Chicago boy who did his PhD dissertation under Milton Friedman. So it will be very important to have his comments on the book. First of all, I would like to thank Universidad del Desarrollo and the History of Economic Society, because we have been engaged in this academic event that's been going on since Sunday, I think, or not. So Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, no back holidays here. And today we have been engaged in different seminars at Universidad del Desarrollo, and they kindly invited Jennifer, so we are taking the opportunity of having her here. So thanks to them for the opportunity, and thanks, of course, to Jennifer and Rolf for being with us. How we will structure this conversation? First, we will give 20 minutes to Jennifer to give a sort of overview of the book, what she did and how she did it. Then we will have a 10 minutes comments from Rolf, especially regarding chapter 12 on the visit of Friedman to Chile. Then I will give another 5-10 minutes overview, general overview of the books. We will have a 20 minute conversation. We will say goodbye to our MLTB participants, and then we will open the seminar for questions and answers from Jennifer and Rolf from the public. And we have here a good number of people, so I'm sure it will be a very interesting conversation. So thank you, Jennifer. The floor is all yours. You can make your presentation.
I'm going to go over to the computer. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much to everyone for coming out tonight. It is a real honor to be here, to be invited by your organization. And this is my first visit to Chile. I'm hoping it will not be my last. As Leonidas said, I was at a conference all of this week, and I'm actually scheduled to come back in the spring of 2026 to teach in the Stanford University, Stanford in Santiago program. So I'm really looking forward to getting to know present day Chile better. So as noted, I'm a historian at Stanford University. I'm also a research fellow at the Hoover Institution. And I specialize in intellectual history, or the history of ideas. And I've had a focus on somewhat neglected figures of the intellectual right. So my first book was on Ayn Rand, the libertarian novelist and philosopher. And my new book is on Milton Friedman. Now, you may not think Milton Friedman is neglected, particularly around here, but this is the first full-length archival account of his life, taking you from his time as a Boy Scout. There he is with the little cap on the far left in Rahway, New Jersey, to the cover of Time magazine in 1969, where you see him as a sort of visionary who will predict a recession, yes or no. And I want to talk today a little bit about how and why I wrote the book, and give you a little bit of the bird's eye view of some of the arguments. So why did I write this book? One answer is because I wrote a book on Ayn Rand, who was also a popular libertarian figure, and so it was natural to look at another person like this. Another reason is I became very interested in the question of neoliberalism. Was a term that Americans were starting to use more and more. I wondered what it meant. I started to investigate. I found it meant many, many things. I became confused at what it meant, but I found one thing almost every person who discussed neoliberalism agreed upon. Milton Friedman was a neoliberal. So I had found a grounding for this idea, and I began looking into Milton Friedman. And then the last real reason is that I took a position at Stanford University, where Friedman spent the last years of his life and had deposited some 200 plus manuscript boxes of his life, from his earliest, you know, transcripts at Chicago, all the way to the last letters he wrote to his fans. So I sort of couldn't resist this project of walk across the street and go to my archive and then go back to my office. So in other words, I had the opportunity to go really deep into this particular figure. And when I started, I was interested in Friedman as a public figure. I was actually not that interested in him as an economist, but then as I got going, I got much more interested in the economics. And so I really have ended up with three Friedmans that are in this book and kind of interweave. There's Friedman the policymaker, Friedman the economist, and Friedman the public intellectual. And these come to the fore at different parts of the book, and sometimes they intermingle. So likewise, I think the book does three main things. It has three main parts that I want to stress. The first is it's a thorough account of Friedman's ideas, from the permanent income hypothesis to monetarism, to his discussion of things like the negative income tax. Secondly, I really put these ideas in their historical context. So I show what Friedman was reacting to, how he was developing these ideas, how they took form in the world, how they changed. And so while I'm showing you Friedman's life, you're also going to get a pretty comprehensive history of 20th century economic thought, 20th century economic change, and political change. Because Friedman's life, you know, he was born in 1913, he dies in 2006, so it covers the arc of the 20th century, and it, as I'll talk about a bit later, it's not just an American story. And then the other thing I really strive to do is to take all of Friedman's ideas and put them in the relationships in which they developed. So whether it's the Chicago School teachers or the other economists that he was debating with, and I think one of the major ways this comes through in the book is I talk about the role of many different women in his career and in his scientific discoveries. And this was something I had not expected when I went into the research, and as I learned more about many of his most important scientific breakthroughs and looked into the archives as to how they happened, I seem to always find a woman there. So here are a few of the figures I talk about. Of course, his wife, Rose, Dorothy Brady, who was Rose's best friend and a sometime colleague of Friedman's. I couldn't even find a picture of her. She's been lost to history, but I found a lot of material in the archive about her. Margaret Reed, who was a professor at the University of Chicago and was part of the group that helped him develop the permanent income hypothesis. And then I talk also about his great collaborator, who is fairly well known today, Anna Jacobson-Schwarz. So, okay, let's go back to these three Friedmans, and I'll talk a little bit about Milton Friedman as a policymaker. And here are a few of the seemingly wild ideas of Milton Friedman's that came to pass. Replacing the United States military draft with a volunteer army. Educational vouchers and public school choice. A world where international currencies float against one another rather than being set by governments. Universal basic income, which is often considered a very left-leaning idea, it's discussed often in progressive circles right now in the United States. And I actually found, this is Milton Friedman's first ever policy paper. It's written around 1939, and it's hard for you to see the title, but the title is A Proposal for a Minimum Guaranteed Income for All. And what I found out is he got this idea in a conversation with Gunnar Myrdal, who is a well-known Swedish socialist who was visiting New York. And the two of them were having a conversation about poverty. And this is the idea that Friedman came up with. And so it goes through various twists and turns in the book, as I describe, and eventually sort of emerges as the earned income tax credit, and I think still shapes a lot of American social policy today. But I also cover his work with people like George Shultz, became a great collaborator of his. Here he's sitting next to Shultz, and he's in the Oval Office with Richard Nixon. Now, by the way, he didn't really like Richard Nixon. He was very suspicious of him. Richard Nixon really liked Friedman liking him and wanted Friedman to like him, and so was always trying to kind of get on his good side and say, Milton Friedman thinks I'm doing the right thing. And then I also talk a lot about his relationship with the Federal Reserve Chair, Arthur Burns, who is not related to me. And I trace the ups and downs of their relationship. And as I talk about Friedman as a policymaker, really the basic argument I'm making here is that even though there's this huge array of policies, you know, from education to the military to international currencies, they all have the same basic idea, which is the application of Chicago price theory to policy. And this seems sort of can seem obvious to us now, like, oh, sure, we think this way, or we might imagine, like, what happens if you let prices, you know, design the policy? But what's really important to know is in Friedman's day, policy, when he was starting out, policy was about prices in that getting the price right, setting the price, controlling the price, making sure the price was affordable. And Friedman sort of flips all that and says, let's actually make the price be the policy. So let's let it lead the way, right? Let's let the international currency exchange be determined by the market rather than being set at the price that we think is right. What is the right price? It's the one that the market sets. So there's a real coherence to all of these different proposals. And so, of course, then Friedman the policymaker is really inextricable from Friedman the economist. And in the book, I go back to the University of Chicago in the 1930s. And this is a really pivotal time because Friedman comes to the University of Chicago in 1932, the absolute worst year of the Great Depression. And so that's going to be one of the puzzles he tries to solve throughout his academic work. Why was this depression so bad? And here I talk a lot about the Chicago School in its early years, particularly his formative teachers, Frank Knight and Henry Simons. And I really talk here about how Friedman encountered in these early years of the Great Depression a distinctive monetary analysis of the Great Depression and a distinctive monetary approach to economic problems that was really different from the Keynesianism that landed at other American universities just a few years later. So it turns out the fact that Friedman started in 1932 as opposed to 1936 or 1934 means he landed in a really different intellectual world. And what's also remarkable is so many of the friends he made at University of Chicago stayed with him for the rest of his life and were his close colleagues, whether it was Rose Director's brother Aaron, who became his brother-in-law, or George Stigler, who came back to the University of Chicago as a colleague. So this is a really formative moment. And because I did this archival research, I can look at different note cards that Friedman took, the syllabi, the drafts of papers he wrote for Frank Knight, and I can get a pretty robust understanding of what he was thinking as a student. And so then I follow him through the growth in the economics profession, through the unfolding of this sort of monetarist Keynesian debate, and the many rivals who at first deride Friedman or mock him slowly start to give him respect as his ideas come to seem more and more plausible. And as I'm looking at, you know, episodes, whether it's his famous attack on the Phillips curve, the development of the theory of permanent income, the emergence of monetarism as a distinct school, which we can summarize with that famous dictum, inflation is always and everywhere a monetary phenomena. I see a lot of continuity with these early Chicago years. So the ideas definitely develop and shift, but I don't believe, sometimes there's a myth out there in some previous writing about Friedman that he was a New Dealer or he was sort of progressive or leftist, and then he switched to being, you know, more classical liberal or conservative or what have you. And I really don't see that. I see from the early years, he's in favor of market economics. He's careful about expanding the government. He does see a role for government in relief programs and in structuring the money supply. But he really is fairly consistent in his intellectual orientation from a young age. So, you know, I follow this long thread of ideas, and then in the end, I try to show a little bit, gesture a little bit about how his ideas about inflation are kind of being newly appreciated in this era of higher inflation that we've more recently entered. And again, as I'm talking about Friedman as an economist, I kept coming into this role of women in his work. And so what I find here is that it wasn't just a sort of coincidence that he worked with these women. It wasn't just that they helped him out. It's that they profoundly affected the way he practiced economics, because what these women led him to was a deeply empirical way of thinking about economics. Now, this is hard to see. This is in Anna Schwartz's handwriting. The title on the top is Vault Cash. And there are, you know, thousands of these very long legal-sized papers in the archives. She is literally adding up the quantity of money held by different banks. And this is what will eventually go into a monetary history and into the argument for the relevancy of the quantity theory of money. And this type of work is women's work in the era of economics that Friedman is in, because the men are building models and they're becoming ever more mathematical. And Friedman is suspicious of that. And so through his work with people like Anna Schwartz, he really does a different type of economics. And I think it's one of the secrets to his success, in that he's thinking differently, he's asking different questions, he's using different methods, and he's coming up with ideas that really lead him to the top of his field. And if you look at the areas that are listed in the Nobel Prize citation, you know, all of those major areas, there's a woman or several women collaborators in the picture there. Okay, so Friedman as public intellectual. So this also weaves through the story, how he came to write popular books like Capitalism and Freedom. And his growing reputation around the world is a big part of this story. So I have two chapters that focus on Friedman outside the United States. One looks at his role in the UK, his relationship with Margaret Thatcher. And it's really fascinating. There are parallel narratives between the UK and the US of sort of economic slowdown, slow growth, high inflation. And there's also a parallel story of Milton Friedman's ideas being considered outlandish, suspicious, suspect, to sort of interesting, really interesting, to coming to really convince people this is the way they ought to go. And so Friedman's ideas end up feeding into this larger phenomena of Thatcherism. And in some ways, Friedman's ideas about privatization, that he spells out many things he thinks should be privatized in Capitalism and Freedom, in some ways these land more in a place like the UK that has a very big state sector. It has state-owned companies in a way that the United States simply doesn't. And then, of course, I have a chapter on Chile. And from the very first talk I have given, I will always get a question about Chile. It was 100% guaranteed with any audience. And so this story in the United States is well known, but it's pretty often a simplified or inaccurate version of this story. So what I tried to do in my chapter is, you know, go back way before 1975 and really set Friedman's visit to Chile and his connection to the country in a much broader context. So I go to the longer story of import substitution, to the Chicago Boys well before the time of Allende. And I really was trying to answer the question, you know, if a figure like Arnold Harberger is really the inspiration and the heart and soul of the Chicago Boys, how is it that Milton Friedman becomes the public face of this whole phenomena? What, you know, how exactly did that happen? So that brings me to look really closely at the 6 days he spent in Santiago at the opening of the Pinochet regime. And I was able to find a travelogue he recorded afterwards. It's about 6 pages where he writes down his impressions of what he saw, what he did. So again, I felt like, and this was never published, and it was just written for his own, you know, kind of, he liked to keep notes on his travel. So I feel like I have pretty good information from his perspective of what he saw and did there, which is important because the press reports are not necessarily trustworthy or not necessarily going to be telling the whole story. So my conclusion with this is that Friedman was mostly a salesman, a sort of pitchman for a policy that had already been decided upon and come together, and he wasn't necessarily the architect or the detail guy in the policy. The other thing that happened was that Friedman's understanding of the economist's job and the economist's role in the world really collided with a new sensibility about human rights that was coming to the fore in the 1970s. So that human rights sensibility really argued that isolation was the only proper moral response to a regime that one did not support. And so this was not Friedman's attitude, and he therefore did not anticipate that visiting Chile would be translated into he must be a supporter of Pinochet and everything the regime does. And so he didn't realize people would interpret that and that he would be blamed. And here's an interesting photo. This is the University of Chicago, where a local group has put up a sign, "Drive Friedman off campus," through protest and exposure. And you can see the word, you know, starvation in Chile. So there was a direct link often made between him and what was happening in the country. And so, you know, Friedman thought rather that it was his duty to give advice. If he was the sort of world expert on inflation, he felt like he knew how to tackle inflation and that this advice would improve the lives of Chileans. Now, he also believed, and apparently he told Pinochet when they met, if you liberalize the economy, you will eventually have to liberalize the society and the politics. And he really truly believe these things went together. And as Chile did liberalize, he felt extremely vindicated. Now, interestingly, that also shaped his view on China. And he was utterly confident that as China began to liberalize its economy over the late 70s and the 80s, that eventually it would be politically liberal as well. And he saw Tiananmen Square as the kind of first of many incidents that would lead to a shift in the Chinese regime. So, you know, I would say the story of Friedman in Chile is probably where the myths and the legends are the strongest. But Friedman himself has become a legend and sort of become a myth. He's become a symbol of these broader political and ideological and economic struggles of the 20th century. And so what I've tried to do as a historian and a biographer is demythologize this story a bit and make it into a human story. And in the end, I hope it makes Friedman someone that you can understand and relate to as a human being, no matter what your take on his ideas. So I could say more, but I know we have such distinguished company, so I will leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jennifer. Now we will have a Rolf.
Okay. Jennifer wrote a tremendous book. It's thoroughly researched. You know, there's a lot of detail, a lot of references, but also a lot of interpretations. I think at the end, looking at the book as a whole, it's a very nuanced description of Milton Friedman. So in that sense, I liked it very much. I also think it's very important to point out that Friedman was not one Friedman. He was at least the three Friedmans Jennifer shows. You know, the Friedman, the economist, Friedman, the intellectual, let's say, and Friedman, the policymaker. So he played these three roles. Mm-hmm. The book is extremely well written, and it reads almost like a novel or something like this. You know, Jennifer always confronts ideas, confronts personalities. He points out something which I did not find, but it's probably so, that Friedman also was a politician, let's say. The Friedman I met, let's say, was a person who was technical, let's say, both in his economics and in his policy making, let's say. He was sort of a technician, let's say. Nevertheless, from the book, you see, you get the impression that he also played an important political role, let's say. Right. Okay, what I want to do is to say a few words about the context in which the visit of Friedman to Chile took place. I want to talk about the first visit and make some comments about that. Friedman came twice down to Chile, between in 75 and in 81, in 1975 and 1981. And so I want to say a few words about the first visit. And then I want to say a few words about the influence of Milton Friedman and the economic reforms in Chile. Okay, going to the context, I think that Jennifer does not, I put down here, discussed sufficiently the context in which the first visit of Milton Friedman took place here. Implicit in her description, there were two alternatives at the time in the early 1970s. One alternative was a market economy under an authoritarian regime. Market economy, authoritarian regime. And the other one was one of a mixed economy and a democratic regime. And if you put it that way, at least I would have no doubts. You know, I would choose obviously the second alternative. But I don't think those were the true alternatives at the time. I think the alternatives at the time were a market economy under an authoritarian regime, one, and the other one was a centralized economy under a totalitarian regime. Those were the years of the Cold War. In 1959, I believe, Castro had taken over Cuba and had instrumented an authoritarian regime in Cuba. The U.S. reacted with the Alliance for Progress. Cuba Castro, let's say, Fidel Castro, tried to influence very much the events here in Chile. Actually, he spent, and you know that, he spent 30 days in Chile traveling around trying to spread his ideas and so on. So the true alternatives available, I think, were not an authoritarian regime versus a democracy. The alternatives were an authoritarian regime versus a totalitarian regime. And I think if that's the case, again, I would have no doubt I would choose the second one. Okay. Now, going to the first visit, I think that his visit was not part of a government plan. Jennifer talks about this visit as part of a plan. That was impossible because I was directly involved in that first visit. And the first visit was the product of a fear we had in our the group, in our financial group. You know, the fear we had in our financial group that the junta at that time. At that time, President Pinochet wasn't that strong again. And so that the junta would opt for a nationalist alternative to the Chicago Boys. And so why? Because the rate of inflation, which was the biggest problem then, I mean, people were only concerned really about inflation. Well, because the rate of inflation, which had reached 600% in 1973, continued to be very high in 74 and 75 even. And so we in our group, in the BHC group, we felt that there was a danger that the junta would say, well, let's take these guys out, the Chicago Boys, and let the nationalists come in. And the nationalists were in favor of not a centralized economy, but a government-managed economy. And we thought that that would not solve the problems, you see. So we said, well, the problem is inflation. If the inflation continues, the junta might decide in favor of the nationalists. So let's bring down the guy who is the expert in inflation and let him, you know, talk to the people and so on, trying to convince, you see, eventually government, but in a very indirect way, very indirect way. Okay, so the meetings we organized were basically two large meetings at the Sheraton Hotel for the general public. One meeting at for the military at the Diego Portales building, and another meeting for the academic world at Católica. Now the meeting at Católica was going to be different. Was going to be a meeting in which Friedman would talk about his ideas about a modern social sort of market economy and his idea about the importance of the economy in the adoption, or let's say in the functioning of a democracy. You mentioned that Friedman believed at some point that if you had an economy which was working well, then that would be consistent only with a democracy. Okay. So that was the difference. But all the other meetings we organized were meetings in which Friedman talked about inflation, which caused inflation, and what should be done, and which caused inflation in the case of Chile was a budget deficit financed by issuing money. And what should be done? Well, we didn't know exactly, but Friedman certainly had it very clear. He was in favor of the shock treatment, and so he talked about that. But what I want to say, you see, is that the Friedman's visit was not to talk to the government officials. In fact, we invited the government officials. We invited Pinochet to receive Milton Friedman, and initially government rejected those visits. And it's only very late when we got a call from the office of President Pinochet that Pinochet wanted to meet Friedman. Now, in that meeting, Friedman talked, and Pinochet listened, and didn't say anything, you know. When I received Friedman at the airport in that visit, he told me that he would say that the only consistent political system with a market economy was a democracy, and that he believed in market economy and therefore in democracy, that he would say that publicly and on the papers and to Pinochet, and he did say it to Pinochet, and when he said that, the only thing he did, he said like that. He didn't say yes or no, but he said yes. Yeah. Okay. So that's it. You know. The final thing is the influence of Friedman in the brick, let's say, in the ladrillo, in the brick, and the influence of Friedman in the implementation of the brick. Well, he had absolutely no direct intervention in the design of the brick or in the implementation of the brick or anything like that, you know. It's interesting to see. We had the Chile project. I don't know. I hope most of you are familiar with the Chile project. This is the contract, the exchange program between Católica, Chicago, and USAID and the U.S. Well, we had this project, and about, I think, the funding of Chileans studying in Chicago was for 25 people, more or less. In Chicago, we had a room which was right together with the rooms of the professors. And actually, Friedman's office was exactly besides our room. 4 or 6, I think, was the number of the room. Well, Friedman never even said hello to us, opened the door, or anything like that, you know. He couldn't care less, really, I think, about the Chicago project. He probably approved of it, but he really wasn't interested. He was interested in the U.S., of course. He was interested in India. He was interested in China, but not in Chile, you know. Chile wasn't anything for him. So, okay, so in that sense, I agree that Friedman had absolutely no influence there. Moreover, both Friedman and Harberger had as a policy not to work for the government in Chile because it was a dictatorship, okay? They decided not to do it. They would talk to the Chilean Chicago Voice, let's say, but they would not, you see, directly be involved in government. Okay, so directly no influence. Indirectly, I think a tremendous influence. I think that he had influence through the faculty. Jennifer explains that very well, how he at some time, you see, basically ran the show at Chicago, and that was so at the time we were there. Okay, then was his academic work. I mean, we all read, of course, all his papers, and well, we listened to to the seminars in which he developed those papers and so on. So we were influenced by him. And the final thing is by his policy proposals, you know, the ideas of markets versus authorities in favor of markets. His ideas about monetary policy, the fixed 3% rate of growth, the voluntary military service, the voucher scheme in all its forms, the idea that that you somehow you might want. He was not opposed to spend some money in social programs and so on, but you had to somehow channel that through the market. You know, that was his idea and what became very important here. And finally, methodology. You see, I think that he was very influential in Chicago in developing the Chicago School, let's say, of economics and the scientific approach to economics in not only in the US, but also in Chile, and through us in the rest of the Latin America, the world eventually. Okay, so that's it. Congratulations, Jennifer, for a tremendous book.
Well, I think Rolf has done the job because I was going to comment on the book. And I basically, let me say a few words because I think it's important to have a conversation, which is the interesting bit. And Jennifer opens the book with a very provocative fact. Friedman inspires awe or rage, love or hatred. He's either, in a way, as a person, as an economist, and as a public intellectual, has been, and still is either loved or hated. That's a fact, I think. And what she does is, as a true historian, she doesn't love neither hate Friedman. As an intellectual historian, she did her research trying to unveil the economist and the man in the context of the 20th century, because he goes all along from the Great Depression, the Second World War, the stagflation, and the battle against inflation. So it's a wonderful book. She spent, and this is something that you should know, more than 10 years reading and dusting off all the sources, not only the relevant literature on Friedman and the Chicago School, but archives on Friedman and on a lot of people related to Friedman, and the press. I mean, combing all the press on those years. So it's an incredible job. And there is a passage in, and I think Jennifer refers to to Anna Schwartz, who co-authored with Friedman the famous book on the monumental monetary history of the US. And she calls Anna Schwartz a bee worker. And I think Jennifer is the bee worker trying to get the facts on Friedman and his context. The book is almost 500 pages, but as Rolf says, you can read it as a novel because it's a combination of good research with a very good prose. So it's strongly recommended. Now, I'm not going to talk more about Keynes and all that because there's a lot that can be said, and I think we can follow with the conversation now. We have the privilege of having with us Rolf Luders, who is a protagonist and also a witness of what happened in those times. As I told you, Rolf is the only one who did, the only Chicago boy who did his PhD under Friedman. So it's an excellent opportunity to talk about Friedman also. But let me begin with Jennifer asking, why did you decide to title the book as the last conservative? Because, I mean, normally people would say Friedman is a classical liberal, limited and representative government, individual freedom, and even and free trade, of course. And some people would say, well, he's a libertarian. But you dared to put him as the last conservative. Why you did so?
Yeah, I get this question a lot, and there's really two reasons. And one has to do with the discipline of economics and one has to do with kind of American politics. And so to start with the economic one first, so one thing that's really interesting about Friedman's career is he, although I showed a picture of Frank Knight and Henry Simons, his actual advisor is a mathematical economist, Henry Schultz, and he also works closely with Howard Hodling, and he's one of the first economists to be trained in advanced statistical and mathematical techniques for doing economics, and he decides, I don't like this. This isn't getting me anywhere. And so he wins the Clark Medal, he publishes these different papers in the kind of rising tide of economics. And when he starts, economists are still writing books, they're still doing political economy, they're looking at institutions, and over the course of his career, they will become more and more focused on mathematical models. And Friedman rejects that trend, which is part of why he is so looked down upon by other economists. They think he's just not smart, he's not doing interesting things, and that's why the partnership with women becomes so important. And then he goes back to the quantity theory of money that's been abandoned in the sort of post-Depression era. Now we're in the Keynesian era. It's not thought to be so important. And he says, no, it's still important. I'm going to bring it back. So if we define a conservative in one way as someone who literally conserves, he is conserving an older way of approaching economics and doing economics and kind of revitalizing it as well. So that's one part of it. The other part really does have to do with the fact that this book was written and published, you know, primarily for American audiences, so I'm delighted to have anyone read it. And the challenge here is this kind of semantic challenge that American conservatism is distinct from many other types of conservatism because it incorporates this embrace of capitalism, this embrace of market dynamism, that generally is considered the opposite of conservative in many other parts of the world. But what happens in the 20th century with the Cold War, with America's somewhat liberal tradition, capitalist tradition, these get blended together, and these get called conservative in opposition to liberal because in the early 1930s, Franklin Roosevelt says, I'm a liberal, the New Deal is liberal. So words are different in the American context. So if I were to write a book, you know, published in America that says Friedman, a great liberal, you know, no one would understand really what I mean. And so part of it was trying to put him in the context of American politics. And the last, I think, is really looking at what is happening in American politics now, that synthesis that really drew together, you know, ideas we might consider liberal or neoliberal, with social conservatism, with strong defense, that is really no longer a synthesis. And I think we're all kind of watching to see what is the new synthesis. But Friedman absolutely represented that. He was a figurehead of that movement. He was one of the people who helped bring that synthesis together and make it popular. You know, I talk about his role advising Barry Goldwater and Ronald Reagan and all these other figures, or informally advising. And so I wanted to kind of situate him and his life as part of something that we knew historically that maybe we're not going to know again, and we ought to take a look back and understand what it was.
We were talking before, Jennifer, about Friedman. He was very horizontal in many ways. He treated everybody the same. And you showed the picture of Nixon with George Shultz, who was Secretary of the Treasury, with Friedman at that meeting. And at the White House, and at one stage, Nixon would say to Friedman, listen, don't blame George for what's going on. And Friedman replied, I do not blame George, Mr. President. I blame you. Okay? So in that sense, he was that kind of character, wasn't he, in terms of how he presented himself in general?
Yeah, I mean, I heard definitely that he had kind of an egalitarian ethos. I also heard that you didn't want to cross him intellectually or he'd kind of put you in your place. He terrified his colleagues. And it's interesting, he had the gift of gab, you know, quick on his feet, just fireworks coming out really quick, where a lot of his other economist peers were a little slower, couldn't quite gather their thoughts. Many were English as their second language. And so he would go up against them in a debate and just slaughter them. But, I mean, I guess I'd like to ask Rolf maybe, yeah, as a student, what was it like being his student? I mean, did you feel like he treated you well?
Yes.
but But it's absolutely true that he was so sharp and so fast and so logical that it was very difficult to somehow, let's say, in a debate, he would always come out the winner. I mean, he was tremendous, tremendous as a public speaker. And he was, on the other hand, he was very egalitarian. He was treating people the same way, and he didn't think he was a sort of a star or anything. He didn't behave at all like a star.
But he was feared during the course of prize theory.
But not the students, not so much, I think. No, the students, not so much. And the seminars, terrible. The seminar. You know, and the Chicago, by the way, started the workshops. You see, as a way to advance economics, the idea was that you would have weekly workshops, and in those workshops, professors would participate and students. Today, this is absolutely the norm, but in those years, it wasn't the norm, and so we had it. Well, in those workshops, Friedman was terrible. I mean, he would really go after you, you know, to see if he could get you. And he usually would get you.
Yeah, he was a good boxer, debating. And Rolf, in that sense, when you were studying there, I mean, and that's why, as you have said, he told Pinochet that economic freedom would necessarily lead to political freedom, which was the argument that capitalism and freedom.
With, yeah.
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 It's something he wrote in 1962 already.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, but he changed his mind a little bit, and you picked it up very well, I think. So he changed his mind after what happened in the last years, in which you had the Chinese regime being totalitarian, let's say, and lasting. Now, that could be because the Chinese regime has both, you know, has a very successful economy, and which is a free economy in a certain way, you know. So,
I have the thesis, Rolf and Jennifer, that he changed his mind in Chile in the second visit, 81, through a letter he wrote to Rodríguez Elizondo.
Yes.
Saying that, well, now he thought that economic freedom would lead to democracy, but now he thought that democracy also needed economic freedom. And that letter hasn't been published, but he told that to Rodríguez Elizondo, and he published the next Newsweek column on that issue.
That same issue.
So probably instead of, we also taught something new to Friedman.
Yeah, how I understood that was, so he came back, I think it was 1981 maybe, 81. And, you know, he had heard this argument from those opposed to Pinochet that you could only have capitalism in an authoritarian regime, and capitalism had been imposed by this authoritarian regime. And then when he arrived in 1981, he heard that argument from the other side, saying that, from people who he considered on the right, saying, oh yeah, we got lucky because we never would have had capitalism without the authoritarianism. He said, no, wait a second. That's absolutely wrong. You have to make a distinction, and you can have capitalism with many different types of systems. And I think it's at that point he realized he'd been a little too glib about connecting them, and that he had been operating in the United States context where democracy was unquestioned, but he felt economic freedom was not sufficiently emphasized. So he'd been really emphasizing economic freedom. And then I think he realized, wait, now that I'm in Chile, if I'm only talking about economic freedom, that's making it seem like I don't care about political freedom or democracy, so I have to readjust.
Yeah. There is another point, Jennifer, you mentioned.
Let me make a thing which is not directly related to the visit of Friedman to Chile, but indirectly, yes. You see, at the time, in the early 1970s, the prevailing ideology about development in developing countries, let's say, was that you only would develop if you have a government planning and allocating resources and so on and so forth. And I think at that time, it would have been very, very, very difficult to have market free market policies adopted in democracy. I think at that time it probably was true that the only way in which you could make those reforms, given the prevailing ideologies under an authoritarian regime. So mm-hmm. I think we could, if imagine Chile 1973, a military coup, military leave, and replace the old democratic regime for a new one with about the same institutions. I think you couldn't have changed the economic institutions.
So yeah, one thing I just think is interesting, there's so much focus on the 1975 visit, but I think in some ways Freeman coming in 1981 and saying to a pretty influential audience, capitalism can flourish with democracy. That was maybe a more important and more impactful message at that time than coming later. I mean, I don't know. And I guess that
Well, from a conceptual point of view, I think, sure.
Yeah.
And I would argue that today, there's no problem. But at those years, I think it would have been extremely difficult.
Yeah, yeah.
Or unlikely. The world really is very unlikely.
Do you think, going back to the 75 visit, do you think his visit made an impact and made a difference in the eventual adoption of the policies?
Well, I'm one of those who thinks it didn't make any difference because Pinochet already, let's say the junta, in those years, the junta already had decided that they would adopt the BRIC as the sort of guiding lines and the Chicago Boys as the guys to implement the program.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So may I just say one other thing that's interesting is that in the United States, Friedman was known for being a gradualist when it came to inflation. And that was his main counsel to Nixon, let's be gradual. But of course, the inflation was much smaller. And so then
the numbers are completely different.
Yeah, but it's interesting. And the other thing I would say is you could have found an American economist who would have said something very different than what Friedman had, but it would have been difficult. I think most American economists would have looked at the situation and it was sort of a basic economic analysis. So it wasn't like Friedman had a super distinct perspective in that moment.
But this is really not an economic problem, let's say. It's in which way do you implement that change in the least costly way? And he has this famous example of the
dog.
If you want to. I don't know if you know that, but
the tail.
Friedman used to say that when he was here in Chile, that you can cut the tail of a cat, I think,
dog.
Of a dog, in two ways. One way is you cut it, the tail off. The other way is you slice it. You know, you cut the thing off, slice. And so obviously it's less costly to cut it at once. And so if the inflation rate is very, very high like we had, and you have a mess, an institutional mess in the economy, probably the best way was to just have a shock treatment. Again, some of you in the audience might know all of this, but you see, one thing is to apply this sort of shock treatment. Another way is exactly what you do when you do that, you know. And that, in this case, there are some people who argue that yes, there should have been shock treatment, but the quantity of money should have been increased much earlier than what actually happened. You see,
Jennifer, you wrote, Friedman was never afraid to be wrong, and more important, never afraid to be unpopular. And probably the Chilean episode is a good example of that. And I remember, Rolf, that you received a letter from Milton Friedman. Remember asking for that tape on his lectures he gave at Universidad de Chile and Católica, The Fragility of Freedom.
Yes.
Yeah. And one letter finished with the free lunch, you remember? Yeah. Because he wrote to you. You have that letter, I think.
I have it. I must have had it somewhere.
But the tape wasn't found, but we have the manuscript of what he said to the students at the time, which is very interesting. And he was unpopular with that, wasn't that?
I mean, the level of unpopularity he received with Chile did upset him.
Yeah.
I mean, it was different. And his daughter recounted to me one of the few times she saw him almost in tears. Someone said, like, Herr Friedman, or made some, like, comparison of him to Hitler. And he was very, very upset by that. And so she'd never seen him, like, cry before, and he was almost on the verge of tears. So that was a totally different level. But he was willing throughout most of his career to be like, that crazy guy who's obsessed with money, which we all know doesn't matter at all. You know, I mean, that was his identity in the profession. And he would go to MIT and get in these fierce arguments with others. But looking back, that was actually kind of the only thing people were debating about. I mean, he was kind of generating debate in the economics profession for decades. It was like everybody else versus Friedman. And so in some ways, it was a very intellectually dynamic profession and field. And eventually it became more narrow. And there's, I think, less of that now. Mm. There's less of the sense of different schools of economics that are really with a lot at stake. Mm.
We have the caricature of Friedman as a mainstream economist, and at some stage you compare him with Keynes, and you say he was among the last economists shaped by the dying tradition of political economy, which blended economics, social, and ethical questions. And in that sense, the negative income tax and the universal
universal basic income
he proposed in 1939 and he defended until the end is a good example, isn't it, Jennifer?
Yeah, and he came up with that idea, as I said, in conversation with Gunnar Myrdal, and then that was his big idea at the first Mont Pelerin Society meeting. He said, this is how we're going to create a new liberalism. This is how we're going to sort of enact Hayek's vision of liberalism that, you know, deals with social problems and inequalities. And he felt like that negative income tax, or originally it was a guaranteed income, would mean there's like a basic floor that's set below people. They can't fall below that floor, but we're not creating a program, we're not creating an authority to give you, you know, money. And you have to remember at that time, say in the United States, if you needed state support, it was often a woman with children, and they would come to the house and look, and they would look for a man's hat. And if they found a man's hat, they would cut your benefit because that man is supposed to be giving you money, right? So very, very invasive. And he thought you should just get a check in the mail, basically. Yeah. So this is his idea that's consistent with freedom, but is also, he thought, consistent with liberalism. So, and the other thing is, he's never a paid government advisor. He's not on the Council of Economic Advisors. He doesn't have to think of all these policy ideas. He just does because he's interested in them.
Yeah. Well, I think we must say hello. I have been monopolizing the conversation and the questions, and we need the Q&As from the public. We have to say goodbye to those who are following us through MLTB. And just to finish with them, I thought the quote from Greenspan, who was also engaged with Friedman when he was at the Fed between 1987, Rodrigo, and 2006, I think, Greenspan. He said the world's biggest brain per square inch of body is Milton Friedman. That's a good quote. So with that, we say goodbye to MLTV. And now we open, of course, questions from the public. So
let me tell you something. He was so small that in the classrooms, we had these desks, you know, and he would jump on the desk, you know. The normal person would just sit down there, but he would jump on the desk. And, well, I met him a few months before he died, and he was really small. I mean, really small. He had become smaller over time.
Well, there is a famous picture of Mr. Micron, Mr. Macron, yeah. Stigler, and Friedman walking.
Which I have on my desk.
Which is wonderful. Well, let's have questions from the public. We'll take three questions and then three questions. There, and then you can take notes.
Well, good evening for everybody. I have one comment and one question. One comment is that Mr. Friedman was very criticized
¿Puedes hablar un poco más fuerte?
Yes. It's okay? That's it. Well, Mr. Vindman was very criticized by journalists and politicians saying that he visited Chile twice. But nobody of some really little people criticized him his visit to China, and he went twice to China. That's my comment. But my question is about the second visit of Mrs. Friedman to Chile. He came in 1981, the second time. And the first time, I'm sure he advised us about the inflation. And the second time in 1991, inflation was totally controlled. And at that time, it started the crisis of debt, and also the exchange rate of Chile, 39 pesos per dollar. What was his advice at that time? That's for Mr. Leaders.
We'll take three questions.
What was
the fixed rate? His advice on that.
What his advice in
Friedman's?
Friedman's advice in 1981.
The microphone. Microphone.
Buenas noches. Una pregunta a la historiadora. ¿Qué hay de cierto que he leído en varios artículos que el grave problema que tuvo la administración del gobierno de Richard Nixon fue la emisión inorgánica de dinero por parte de la Reserva Federal Americana? ¿Quiere decir entonces que no había tanta llegada de Milton Friedman al presidente Richard Nixon?
Nixon, the problem was issuing money, so Friedman was not that influential during the Nixon government. That's a question. Yeah. And we have another.
Can you take the student?
Yeah, the student, and and then Richard. We have three. We'll take four questions, and then.
Yeah, I want to get the student.
Thank you so much, Jennifer and Rob. It's a beautiful, beautiful, wonderful lecture and chair. And like the comments on about China and the capitalism and democracy is interesting too. So my question is, like, the neoliberalism and Milton Friedman's entire economic theory has been very beneficial to the economics of Chile, but there are also a little critics about the poverty, about inequality and polarization in Chile. So how did he respond to that? And also, how did the politicians and him trying to fix that through policies, economic policies? Thank you.
Richard, the last one, and then we make another round.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Very, very interesting. I apologize to being late. I've been following a little bit about Friedman, and you can see the videos. And there's one thing that got my attention. They ask him, well, would you be the Secretary of the Treasury in the U.S.? And said, no, I'm an academic. I'm not going to go into politics. I want to have my freedom in the debate. The second, that he was prepared to go to these shows, like Donovan, I think, where he was speaking to very common people about freedom. And then he had these programs, I think, Free to Choose, with his wife. And my question, Jennifer, is, and Rolf, what influence did he have? Because he is one of the last I've saw, probably there's been somebody after, that went into the public to speak about freedom. And Milei, you know, to put the, no, I don't know if it's a similar case, also using television at that time, and in a very family-oriented program, like Donovan, for example. Did that have an influence in the thinking and what happened afterwards in the US? Thank you.
Thank you. We begin with Jennifer, then Rolf, and the other round, the other way around.
Okay, so I'm going to let one of you two talk about the exchange rate, because I know you've written something about that in more detail. On the question of the Nixon administration, do they want me to use this for the...
No.
No, okay.
It's for you if you want translation from...
Hopefully someone can translate for him so he can get my answer.
No, he's got...
Oh, you have it. Good.
It was for you from Spanish to English.
So the issue with the Nixon administration, so Milton Friedman's mentor and advisor and someone he really loves is Arthur Burns. And Arthur Burns is chair of the Federal Reserve. But Arthur Burns does not believe Milton Friedman's ideas about inflation. And so... Arthur Burns won't listen to Milton Friedman, even maybe does what Milton Friedman says not to do. And Arthur Burns wants to help Nixon get reelected. So before the election, lots of money, after the election tries to shut it down, but already inflation is going up. So that happens all through. And then Nixon decides to do price controls. And Arthur Byrne says, yes, you should do price controls. And so then Friedman, it's like heartbroken. And they have a big, he writes him a long letter. It's all in the book. It's a big drama. And the friendship kind of ends at that point. Yeah. And then there was a question about
freedom, China.
Yeah, the one about inequality, and I think, yeah, I mean, it's a puzzle. If you look at the chart of inequality, it's going down. Maybe it's not gone down enough. I think regional comparison, Chile looks really good in the reduction of inequality, but I think a lot of it is this subjective feeling people have about their opportunity. And if they have the same opportunities they once had. So there maybe is a feeling that inequality comes down so fast and then it slows and people want it to keep coming down as fast as it has been. So it's a very tricky question. And I think if I read people writing on it and it's not obvious, you know, why you have improvements and then such discontent simultaneously, but it's maybe part of the human mind. And then I would say, about going on the TV and free to choose. One place you can see that influence is that he almost becomes a spokesperson for the presidential campaign of Ronald Reagan, who is saying, I will reduce the size of government and I will, you know, bring more freedom. And then you have a respected economist saying the same thing. So I think he helped make Reagan sound more reasonable in that way. And then he really adored Reagan, but he also, at the end of his life, was like, wait a second, government is still getting bigger. And my political idols have been in power, but government is still getting bigger. And he was disappointed. And so he never really worked it out. He, I think, would have favored, you know, a constitutional limit on raising taxes, but the dynamic of the federal government became growth, and it's sort of been that way ever since. And he felt really disappointed that he had won the intellectual battle, but the institutions marched on.
Thank you. Rolf?
Yeah. On the exchange rate, Friedman was obviously in favor of a floating exchange rate regime worldwide, let's say. But he made an exception. You see, he would say that in the case of developing countries, he would prefer a fixed exchange rate, what he called a unified exchange rate, which means just getting rid of local currencies and adopting the dollar, let's say, as the basic thing. So when he came down to Chile, he found that we had a fixed exchange rate, but we did not have a unified exchange rate. However, because Sergio de Castro, one of his students, let's say, was in the Ministry of Finance and so on, he was very careful to avoid, let's say, any critical comment about the exchange rate policy we were following. Now, by the way, at that time, the monetary approach to the adjustment of the balance of payments, which had been developed, let's say, popularized by Bob Mandel, that was the prevailing ideology, let's say. So we were following the prevailing ideology at the time. And, well, of course, once the financial crisis of 82 came, we had to devalue, let's say. Ah, yeah, okay, I have to go on, yeah?
All right. Another question?
Yeah. Inequality. Yeah. The Chicago boys believed that income distribution was not that important. That the important thing was reduction of poverty. That people, you see, would, if you got rid of poverty, no matter how unequal income distribution is, if you got rid of poverty, then you allowed everybody to fulfill himself to its full potential. So the idea was, let's get rid of poverty. And in that sense, the program was extremely successful. I mean, I think by any standard, we are one of the two countries which have the highest rates of reduction in poverty. Now, in terms of inequality, inequality has come down, you see. But if you look at the history of Chile, we have inequality indices starting in 1850. And in general, the Gini coefficient was always between 0.5 and 0.6, fluctuating around that. Now we are much lower. We are at 0.47 or something like this. And, people still complain, let's say. Mm-hmm. Yeah. The final thing is free to choose. That's something you had to answer, you see.
The episode. Now we will take the final round of questions. We have one there. There.
Rodrigo.
And Rodrigo.
For Mr. Lewis, do you think that Mr. Friedman was... Mr. Friedman was more heard and understood by high-ranking Navy officers in the Junta, because I understand that there was a conflict between the military officers from the Army and the Navy officers, which had, I think, had a clearer view of these two approaches to economy. And if that was important in pushing the reforms that were implemented.
Another question here. We'll take three questions.
Yeah, pero ¿qué dijo él?
De la influencia, si tuvo más influencia en la Armada que en los militares, en la naval.
En la cuestión económica, sí. La influencia sí. Relativa. Sí.
Thank you, Jennifer, for your book and your presentation. It really reads like a novel. No? I could today read a bit of it, and it's very highly engaging. But my question is about this... this empirical work of Milton Friedman with his woman collaborators or whatever, with his collaborators. You said at the beginning of your conference that was the key for new questions, this empirical work of Milton Friedman. But at the same time, he produces one of the more abstract theories in the economy of money, of freedom, in the 20th century. So if you can explain a little bit more about his methodological work, from going from the data, from empirical data, from these thousands of sheets of data to the abstract theory that he developed. How was the steps that he followed from passing from the concrete work to the abstract work?
And another question there.
Thank you very much, Jennifer and Rolf, for these presentations. Now, Friedman, of course, is known for his writings and ideas on many subjects. One of them is monetary policy. He has his book with Anna Schwartz. He's also his 68-year paper on the role of monetary policy is very important. He's another lecture where he also addresses monetary policy. Now, he's basically very skeptical about active monetary policy. He blames the Federal Reserve for at least what happened during the Great Depression. And his prescription is, let's have a sort of passive monetary policy, the rule, the K percent rule. Let's target monetary aggregates. If we target monetary aggregates, then we'll have a stable nominal income and inflation. But the fact of the matter is that there is no central bank in the world that follows that prescription. Central banks target interest rates because they have come to a conclusion that velocity is not stable. If I'm not wrong, I think I read an interview in the last part of his life where he said something like, well, I don't believe that much in these policies, but I actually have to admit that they work. I think that this was during Greenspan era as chair of the Fed. Did he have some sort of mixed feelings regarding his prescriptions on monetary policy at the end of his life?
Thank you, Rodrigo. We begin the other way around?
Yeah, I should Rolf. Start. You know. Yeah. ¿Qué es lo que dijo Rodrigo?
De la influencia de Volcker, yo creo. El tema, si estaba equivocado finalmente su teoría monetaria.
Friedman.
Sí, agregado monetario.
Yeah. Actually, there's this very interesting say. There was a former Bank of Canada governor which said something like, it is not that we abandon monetary aggregates. They abandoned us. I mean, so.
You want me to start with this last question? Yeah. Can we go back?
Then Jennifer will start, and then
we
go to...
Yeah, why don't I start with this one?
Yeah. Or you prefer to start, Rob?
Start.
So, yeah, this is a really, really interesting question. And so I cover this in a lot of different ways in the end of the book. So one thing that happens is Friedman's analysis of the monetary aggregates are built for a regulated world, and they are adapted in a deregulated world. And this happens in the United States and the UK almost simultaneously. Because of the high inflation of the 70s, there's a deregulation in the 80s. So then when they start to target the aggregate, it's going all over because you have interest rate, now savings are giving you, or checking is giving interest rates, so people are moving money the same way. So the whole thing blows up. So aggregates don't work. On the other hand, I tend to look at the kind of 30,000-foot view in which many of Friedman's basic principles of monetary policy are adopted, that it works with a lag, that it should be somewhat passive rather than active. And the interest rate question, what he's really striving to do is to say interest rates are not necessarily, there's not such a clean predictive relationship, and that's absolutely what Paul Volcker adopts when he notices in the 70s. Once you're in high inflation, interest rates are not acting the same as in low inflation. So it doesn't come to pass, but I do look at things like inflation targeting, interest rate rules. I mean, John Taylor, who's one of the foremost proponents of interest rate rules, really thinks of himself as in the rules versus discretion debate and thinks of himself in the like Henry Simons, Milton Friedman kind of creating rules rather than discretion. And so what happens with Friedman is he, in the 80s, he starts with making all these predictions of inflation that don't come to pass. And so he kind of has egg on his face. Then he ends up, he's puzzled. I don't know why the Fed has got it right in the Greenspan era. And you have these quotes saying, so I wouldn't push aggregates as hard as I would. Later on, though, he gets a computer and he starts running data and he basically says, I still believe that M2 is pretty predictive of inflation aside from this like 5-year period in the 80s. And he says, I pretty much think that we've had low inflation globally because we've come to a more consistent and steady monetary policy. So he is able to kind of, I think, feel comfortable with his overall analysis at the end, even though the details don't really work. And I think the institutional changes are so profound, they don't really work. But if you abstract the big picture lessons, it's still really fundamental. So I would say that. And then just in the current, you know, inflation debates, there were a lot of Friedman followers who were like, you know, M2 is really going up and that's going to cause you a lot of trouble. And the US Fed was like, oh no, that doesn't matter at all. And they wouldn't even countenance the idea that it might matter. And so they were very back-footed on when it actually did unfold. So I think there's still some juice in that analysis, provided you don't push it too hard. This is making me want to carry on to the empirical work question.
Yeah, let's go.
And so there's kind of two pieces of that. So one I could say, one example would be of a monetary history. And he went into the research for a monetary history with a thesis that the Federal Reserve had been disruptive to economic stability in the United States. He absolutely had that thesis. And then they, you know, added all the figures to show the different quantities of money. They did not have the 30% drop in the money supply during the Great Depression. He had a suspicion that the Great Depression was monetary in nature, and he had a suspicion about the Fed, but he didn't have the data to show the really the cratering of the money supply. So that was a kind of method where you have a thesis, you test it against the data, and the thesis then is borne out by the data. With the permanent income hypothesis, there were some questions around the Keynesian consumption function that were kind of general. That, you know, many people in the profession had these questions. And then he had Dorothy Brady and Margaret Mead and Rose Friedman had been in discussion of consumption data over many decades. And then they ended up, Brady and Mead ended up with a big project with a lot of data. And they couldn't make any sense of it. And they would come and visit the Friedmans in their summer home, and they would talk about the problems they were seeing. And over a couple of summers, they were like, well, what about this? Like, could this theory explain it? Could that theory explain it? And eventually they hit on this permanent income hypothesis, and it was like, ah, now this data seems to make sense. So that was more the theory emerging from the data. And that was what he, one of the ways I, you know, he defined Chicago economics was theories that are empirically tested by data. And then, of course, theories that ideally predict, you know, what will happen. So I think those are, it worked in different ways, but he was always, you know, looking at this really fine-grained data, like with the permanent income hypothesis, it was like, when do farmers buy new equipment? Like, how are their crop sales? You know, really, it was really in the guts of the economy.
Thank you, Jennifer. To close, okay. Rolf, on the...
On the influence question of the relative importance of the army versus the navy or the air force and the police in economic policy in those years and the reforms, the navy was in charge. In those years, in the initial years of the military government, we had president, and we had a Congress, let's say. The president was Augusto Pinochet. The Congress were the four generals.
Merino.
Yeah, but the ¿cómo lo llaman?
Commander?
Commander in chief.
Yeah, commander.
Commanders in chief. Yeah. Were the four commanders in chief. Now, the commander in chief in charge of economic policy was the Navy. The commander-in-chief in charge of social programs was Mattei. The commander-in-chief of security and stuff like that was the police general, and so on. Okay. So the process was one in which any project of law and so on would be reviewed first in the case of economic policy, would be reviewed first at the Navy. But then it would go to all the other three commissions, which could also make comments. So I wouldn't say that the Navy had sort of the monopoly power in economic policy. It didn't, you know. They all participated together. Now, at the end of the story, the one who had the real power was the president, Augusto Pinochet. He could decide on anything, you know, in fact. I don't know if that answers your question.
Well, I think we are very much on time. 1 hour and a half we have been having a wonderful conversation. It has been a real treat for us to engage with this wonderful book and having the company of Rolf with great comments. Very much appreciate that you have been with us, and let's give a big applause to Jennifer and Rolf. Amazon.